the Jewish people. As to the Pollard question, I think that, you know, the insinuation in your question was probably accurate, which is that there is a level of anti-Semitism that has really been prevalent in the U.S. government's handling of Pollard's crime. And again, Pollard was a criminal. He committed a crime. He transferred a privileged information, classified information, to a foreign government, and this is a major crime. But it's important to recognize that the life sentence that he received for having committed this crime is grossly disproportionate to the punishments that other American criminals have received for committing similar crimes of transferring classified information to countries that are allied with the United States. The general prison term for that crime is 2 to 5 years in prison.
And with that, sir, we thank you for two very interesting questions, to be sure. And as if you were Rabbi Hillel standing on one leg, your two-minute explanation of eternal anti-Semitism is rather dazzling. Indeed, that is an eternal question, is it not?
Sure is, because it's an eternal hatred.
Exactly. By email, a listener, namely John, says, what was the original role and what is the current role of Jordan, Syria, Saudi Arabia, and the other remaining Arab countries in resolving this issue? By this issue, I presume he's talking about the status of Israel and the Palestinians.
Well, you know, all of those countries, I don't want to go back too far in history, but all of those countries that you mentioned, as members of the Arab League, declared war on Israel and either sent forces or financed the invasion of Israel in 1948 with the stated aim of that war being wiping the Jewish state off the map and throwing the Jews into the sea. So all of these states from the very beginning were members of a coalition whose goal was annihilatory. In terms of their views of Israel. And, you know, over time, different countries have played different roles. Now, Jordan was unique because its initial ruler, King Faisal, was willing to live at peace with the Jewish people. He signed a peace deal, actually, in 1919 with the early Zionist leader Chaim Weizmann, called the Faisal-Weizmann Agreement, whereby Faisal would rule Syria, which at that time was supposed to be Syria, Lebanon, and Jordan, or actually just Syria and Lebanon, and the Jews were to have control under the League of Nations mandate system of all of the historic land of Israel, which included not only Israel, but what is today Jordan. So, you know, the Hashemites who rule Jordan really have a unique history in the sense that their leadership role in the Arab world traditionally was one that was allied with the West and that was willing to live at peace with Israel. But again, despite that, because of the weakness of the Hashemites, they participated in two wars against Israel, and only signed a peace with Israel in 1994.
Back to the phones, 312-591-7200, and we go next to Mike, who joins us at WGN Radio. Good evening, sir.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. Mm-hmm. First, thanks for playing a clip from Netanyahu. It's I never heard it before. It's nice to compare and contrast someone who knows 4,000 years of history with someone who thinks, with a leader who thinks America has 57 states. My question is, and I don't want to sound anti-Semitic, but I think Israel is its own worst enemy. There was a Franciscan priest in Chicago that communicated daily with people in the West Bank, and he documented how Israel, under the rule of Ariel Sharon, chased Arab Christians out of the West Bank. Now, you have to believe that Christians of Arab descent are closer religiously to Jews than they are to Muslims. Why was that tolerated?
You know, I'm not really aware of what this Franciscan priest has documented. What I can tell you, though, is a couple of things about that period when Ariel Sharon was the prime minister. The first thing that I can mention to you is that the Palestinian Authority effectively held the Christians of Bethlehem and Beit Jala hostage by shooting rockets and sniper fire at neighborhoods in southern Jerusalem from Beit Jala beginning in 2000, and they were doing it from Christian homes against the wishes of the owners. And there was a massive flight of the community, the Christian community of Beit Jala, from their town to South America as a result of the tactics, the anti-Christian and anti-Israel tactics that were used by Palestinian security forces at that time. And I think it's also important to mention the fact that the Palestinian Fatah terrorists took control over the holy Christian church in Bethlehem, the Church of the Nativity, for weeks in 2002 during Operation Defensive Shield, where they held priests hostages, defaced the church, destroyed Bibles, and so on and so forth, essentially did committed a crime against one of not only the priests themselves and the nuns who were there at the time, but also to a sacred site for Christianity. And this was not what Israel did. What Israel was doing was trying to prevent further suffering from the priests who were being held hostage. They were feeding them any time that they had the opportunity to do so. So, you know, the facts on the ground point to a different reality than those that you, the Franciscan priests that you mentioned at the outset alleged. And I don't, again, I haven't seen any of the documentary evidence that you mentioned, but I must say that since the establishment of the Palestinian Authority in 1994, Bethlehem's Christian population has dwindled from over 80% of the population to somewhere along the lines of 10% of the population of that traditionally Christian city. This is due to Palestinian rule, not to Israeli rule. Israel transferred responsibility for Bethlehem to the Palestinian Authority in 1996.
All right. Thank you.
And we thank you, sir, for the call, and we will return after a last quick round of commercial messages.
Extension 720 with Milt Rosenberg on 720 WGN.
And before we go back to the phones, it's a moment in which we need to take a quick commercial for ourselves as regards the podcasts that are available to you on the program website. The program website is arrived at if you just go to wgnradio.com/extension720. wgnradio.com/extension720. There you'll find, as well as lots of other things, podcasts of literally hundreds of programs. All the recent programs are on that front page, somewhat less recent if you just hit the link that says many more podcasts. Tonight's program will be up by later tomorrow, surely. But also on the front page are loads of classic programs. We rotate them some, but among others, one that we've kept up for quite a while is a conversation with Carl Sagan. Another is a conversation with Henry Kissinger. And as I just read right now, a program on the origin of language, a program on the history with lots of illustrated examples of American country music, titled High Lonesome. That being the title of a book by the author under interview in that. The Roman Empire, two excellent classics scholars, one of them Dan Garrison, a rather frequent guest on this program. Alan Ryan did a book a few years ago, we just put it up recently, titled Quiet Neighbors, Prosecuting Nazi War Criminals in America. Speaking of Nazi war criminals, a program again way back from 1988, but about the Munich Pact and what lay behind its conception and its signing. James McPherson, the great Civil War historian, in a book about the Battle of Antietam, actually, and Der Besuch des historischen Jesu, that is to say, the quest for the historical Jesus. Three biblical scholars, one of them, Bart Ehrman, joined us in that conversation about 12 years ago. That and much else is available for you at wgnradio.com/extension720. If you haven't tried it before, jump in. You'll like it. 312-591-7200 is our number as we go back to the phones. And next up is Scott. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. I'm a big fan of Carolyn. It's only back a couple of years. I started reading your column one, and I've been hooked ever since. I have three questions. Two of them concern American elections, but I know obviously the Jews can post followers that closely. In light of the previous presidents, including this one, who have campaigned as Zionists and then they become Arabists after an election, I'd like to know if you believe that any of the GOP candidates will finally commit a definite date to moving the embassy to Jerusalem. The second question I have is, in light of the fact that the settlements have always been a red herring and a phony issue, do you believe that any of the candidates will commit to finally ending the nonsense about the settlements and basically just let Israel do what they have to do? And the third question I have is, I read a disturbing column in your paper last year sometime about an increasing problem in Israel itself of Arabs that are basically squatting land and basically they're taking over swaths of land inside Israel, and the army is too afraid, whatever, to do anything about it. I want to know if that's true. And so those are the three questions I have.
Those are well-packaged questions. Sir, if you'll permit, I'm going to hang up, though, because your phone is a little disruptive. It's making some sort of a pocky noise, but please listen on the radio and let's proceed to that.
So you're right that part of the interesting thing about the presidential election is that because the American public so overwhelmingly supports Israel and a strong relationship with between the United States and Israel, you tend to have American presidential candidates always proclaiming everlasting support and friendship with Israel. And what we have seen, in fact, is things like the Obama administration's campaign now to against Israel's continued control over Jerusalem, despite statements absolutely to the contrary that Obama made during his candidacy. And I think that it's very important to hold people to standards if you want them to abide by them. And, you know, I was very upset to see that the American Jewish Committee and the Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith published a statement calling for a bipartisan pledge to not bring Israel in as an election issue in the 2012 election. I thought that it was just almost a public service announcement for Democrats. But I really think that, you know, politicians tend to do what the public demands them to do in democracies. And so if supporters of Israel are willing to really put down a benchmark and say, we want to know when you're going to move the American embassy to Jerusalem, that candidates will have to make a statement to that effect. And I think that it's an important thing to do. As to the second question was... oh, darn it. I can't remember. Now I'm drawing a blank. Anyway, Mel, do you remember what the second or third question was?
It came so
were?
Quickly, I can't reproduce it either. Don't worry about it.
Oh, the settlements. Just, again, you know, you're right. I think part of the problem isn't so much in the United States. I think that it's in Israel, and that once Israel starts asserting its rights to Judea and Samaria and the West Bank of the Jordan River, we will have supporters of Israel standing up and saying, you know what, you're right, this is something that makes sense to support, but for as long as you have a successive Israeli government saying that they're willing to make peace with the PLO and yield these territories to the Palestinians, it becomes much more difficult for American politicians to make that statement.
If I can intrude for a moment on this, one consideration in favor of the no two-state solution but incorporate the West Bank and make is making all those Arab residents citizens of Israel.
Right.
The Palestinian or Arab residents of Israel in its original limited geographic range have done better economically and probably culturally than any other such group in the Middle East, don't you think?
Yeah, and actually that reminds me of what his third question was, which is about the unlawful behavior by many Arab Israelis right now. And I think that you have to—and first of all, the answer to your question is yes, we've had massive land squatting on the part of Israeli Arabs, particularly in the Negev and in the Galilee. And this very much is the result of a constant stream of incitement by the Palestinian Authority towards the Israeli Arab community, urging them to become more radical and irredentist and reject Israel's right to assert its sovereignty over non-Jewish minorities in the state in order, again, to overthrow or delegitimate Israel's right to exist.
And